It's great to be able to provide for your family. Wouldn't it be great to be able to provide for yours well and someone else's? Yeah. Wouldn't it make you feel good to go up behind somebody in HEB or Kroger? This little mother's there. She's scraping her dimes and nickels together to feed. She's got a couple of kids hanging on her. And even if their noses are dirty or not, you still bless people. And she doesn't have quite enough money. And you say, hey, I want to take care of this. I want to bless you. Not I want to hand something out to you. I want to bless you. I want to sow seed into you. And you don't make a big deal about it, but maybe you don't even say anything. You tell the register lady, I'm going to take care of it. And they tell the lady that your groceries are paid for. But you can't do that when you're barely scraping by yourself, right? Well, God didn't make us to be a barely get by people, right? So when I tell you about these things, it's because I want us to prosper together. I want us to prosper even as our soul prospers. And if we want to be prosperous in our bodies and in our finances, our soul, our mind, will, and emotions must prosper. We've got to get ourselves to that point. And the thing that I wanted to just hit real quick, if you go to Luke 9, I'm going to skip jokes this morning. Hopefully I'll be funny enough when I speak. Amy told me the other day, I was in the car with her, I said, why don't you laugh when I make jokes? You're not funny. That's what she said to me. You're not funny. You're really only ever funny when you speak. So I love it when you speak because you're funny, but when we're together, it's just not there. You know, I try to be goofy with the kids. If I give myself to my nature, I'm stoic. I'm like Spock. I am not like Sulu. I want to make that clear. Some of you will get that later. No, anyway. So many things happen that I just want to say things about, but anyway, I could talk about the election or coming election. No, okay, when we get closer I'll talk about it, but for the sake of time, so go to that scripture, because we know the Bible's always good. I want to tell you about two things real quickly that will end your prosperity quicker than anything else. Everybody wants to have an abundant life, but a lot of people are sabotaging their own abundance. Guilt and resentment are enemies of prosperity. Guilt and resentment are projected differently, but cause the same vibratory frequency in your body that's destructive and counter-abundant. What I mean is this. I might as well come. Tony, come here. Help me. Let me move this stuff down there. Not that, just that. And then I'll bring the rest. Resentment and guilt are two things that if you don't keep yourself in check, you will end up, it's almost like you're shooing abundance away from you. They both, yeah, I'm ready. Let's do that. They both cause the same frequency in your body. Now, what I'm telling you that for is because every single person here is a big mass of energy. Your body is energy. You operate at a frequency. And some of you may have studied this, some of you may know this, but there's, when I, if I come up to Roger and I give him $100 bills, you know, whatever, there's something that happens concerning feelings and frequency. In his body, there's an energy level that goes up and he gets excited. That's the feeling caused by an action or caused by something that he didn't. In the same case, if I went and I stole $200 from Terry, he would have feelings in the opposite direction. And it's a negative energy. It's a negative frequency. And what I want to tell you is that resentment and guilt, even though they're pointed in different directions, guilt is pointed at yourself for something you did. Resentment is pointed at someone else. But your body is the only beneficiary of either. Wow. And so what happens is the energy that comes with guilt and resentment bottles itself up in you, and it actually moves you away from where you want to be. Wow. And see, this is even proven scientifically. Take God all the way out of it. Why? Because when you're in resentment or guilt, and most guys, when they're in resentment or they're mad, they act out. They'll tell people that they're not happy about it. Sometimes women, though, do the silent treatment. They're passive aggressive. And they'll, you know, and don't poke your wife or your husband or anything right now if you want to live. But sometimes women are like that, and they'll remove themselves from community, which is the very thing they need. Because most of the time, people that offend you really are the people that love you. You want to know how not to get offended? Don't be offendable. You should say, on your card, you should say, "I'm so happy and thankful that I am unoffendable." Pulled my pocket out. But you can be that way. Nobody offends you. It's like nobody makes you mad. You let yourself become mad. You let yourself become, "Well, you don't know what they did to me." I don't have to know what they did to you. I've had crap done to me that curl your toenails. And I've had people betray me before and do terrible things for me. But they don't make me feel any way. They give me the opportunity. And I either take the opportunity or I say no thank you. It's the same with guilt and resentment. One, you shouldn't live in guilt because you've been exonerated by the blood of Jesus. Doesn't mean you keep doing the same thing over and over again like a goofball, but you receive the blood, you get over it, and then resentment is just bad stuff. And I wanted to read this scripture to you, and it was in Matthew, and was it Matthew or Luke? He said to another, "Follow me," it's Jesus talking, "accept me as master and teacher." This is the Amplified. But he said, "Lord, allow me first to go home and bury my father." But he said to him, and then in the Amplified, I like it a lot better because it says, "Allow the spiritually dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and spread the news about the kingdom of God." Jesus was not in the habit of putting anybody on staff who was dead on the inside. Nor was he in the habit of telling them to go take care of those who were spiritually dead or weren't going anywhere. "I'm sending you to the lost sheep of Israel," and that was his assignment. But what I'm telling you is, when you partner with resentment or guilt, you're partnering with the dead. Yes. Let me read the Strong's explanation of it. The word is nekros, and you've heard of that word before in the Greek. A corpse or a dead body, what lacks life. Unresponsive to life-giving influences, inoperative to the things of God. And so when we partner with resentment or guilt, we're partnering with something that's inoperative and unresponsive to the things of God. And when we are that way, what it tends to happen is that consumes our life and we think about it all the time. We go through it in our mind over the time. Did you know that your body does not know the difference? And I'm going to take it out of us. A child was abused as a child physically. Either their mom or dad slapped them around or did something like that, or, God forbid, they were sexually abused. If a child doesn't learn to forgive by faith, even when they don't feel like it, and they continue to live in that place, what will happen is their body won't know the difference between the physical act and the mental rehearsal. Because your mind is so creative and so powerful, it will put you back in this state of origination. Does that make sense? So it takes you back to that moment. That's why when you're dreaming, I woke up because she's hit me at night, because she had a dream that I was with another woman. Well, I'm laying, you got mad at me before. I think you even hit me. Okay, you never hit me. Maybe it was the other way around, I hit her. I have woke up at night before and had one of those dreams, and she was like close to me, and I get away from her, and I push her away. Well, she's right there next to me. She's not fooling around. But my mind has convinced me it's the truth. And sometimes it takes a little while to get out of that, you know. I'm just saying. Oh, don't. Some of you say act like you've never had that happen before. Give me a break, you righteous liars. Anyway. But your mind is powerful. That's all I'm really trying to say. You can have a dream that seems totally real. Well, when we rehearse things over and over in our mind again, that's what we're telling our mind. That was real. That was real. That was real. I've got to keep talking about it. I've got to keep, instead of releasing it and letting go of something that's dead. Because if you keep something on you that's dead, if you go get it down to the morgue and grab a corpse and strap it to your back and start walking around with it, one, it's going to weigh you down. Two, the decay on that body, which is an energy, it's an energy towards death, will eventually attach itself to you, and you'll die from the same thing. Don't try it. Just trust me. So, I just wanted to say that real quick. Guilt and resentment are enemies of abundance. All right. Now, I want everybody to say this with me. I'm equipped to walk an abundant life. Nobody can keep it from me. If God is for me, no one can be against me. And I won't blame anyone else for my failure. I'll get up and I'll go again. Roll the video.
You ain't gonna believe this, but you used to fit right here. I'd hold you up and say to your mother, this kid's gonna be the best kid in the world. This kid's gonna be somebody better than anybody ever knew. And you grew up good and wonderful. It was great just watching. Every day was like a privilege. Then the time come for you to be your own man and take on the world, and you did. But somewhere along the line, you changed. You stopped being you. You let people stick a finger in your face and tell you you're no good. And when things got hard, you started looking for something to blame, like a big shadow. Let me tell you something you already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you got to be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that. I'm always going to love you no matter what. No matter what happens. You're my son, you're my blood. You're the best thing in my life. But until you start believing in yourself, you ain't gonna have a life. Don't forget to visit your mother.
You know, it's a movie, but it's so true.
Yeah.
Rocky. I was going to try to read it, but I couldn't do it like that. You know, Sylvester Stallone. And you know that when he was when he wrote Rocky, he was offered, nobody would cast him. He really wanted to be in it. And somebody offered him like $35,000 for the movie, for the rights to it. But he would never be able, he would lose all his rights. And people kept saying no and no and no and no until finally, and he said, no, I'm not going to sell it. It's mine. It's I've got to do this. And he finally found someone who said yes. And we know what happened after that. It became a blockbuster series. And I wanted to show that because it's almost like God's looking at you saying that.
Yeah.
You got to believe in you because of what I put in you. Mm-hmm. You have to believe, and you can't blame anybody else. You can't walk under somebody else's shadow. You got to believe in what I've put in you. And I wanted to just go through a few things that people often say about abundance. One, people don't think God wants them to be abundant. And we've actually been, some people, I've never been taught that. Has anybody ever been taught that it was not, you're not supposed to have a prosperous life as a Christian? You were taught something like that, that you're supposed to be content with what you have. Or, you know, if I say something, just raise your hand. Hands are going all over the place. Don't shoot too big. Don't go too high. God's called you to a certain thing, and he may not bless you like he blesses other people. I don't know if that's one anybody's ever heard. But I want to tell you, Peter said, I perceive God's no respecter of persons. And the same blood that paid the price for a prosperous Christian is the same blood that paid the price for a unprosperous Christian. You understand what I'm saying? Just a second, buddy. We'll talk after. And so you have to understand and realize it's the same blood that pays for everything. And so one person could be on the lowest step, you know, they were homeless, and then they got into a shelter and they said, God provided, thank you, God. And then somebody could be moving into a $2.4 million home and said, thank you, God, for providing. And they're both thanking the same source. And I want to tell you that it takes no more effort for God to provide a shelter for a homeless man than it does to provide a $2.4 million house for one of his children, because they're all his children. They're just at different levels. We're all at the same set of stairs. We're just at different places on it. And some people think they should just get by. They shouldn't be prosperous, and just getting by should be enough. Some people think that they don't deserve it. Some people are more ambitious than others, and they're not sure if God's okay with them being rich or not, but they've tasted it and they want it. So maybe they just don't talk to God about it a lot because they don't want him to say no. And so I'm just telling you, these are things people think. The truth is, though, that we're all called to an abundant life. We're all called to that. And there's people that say, well, I don't want any of that. I don't want to be rich. And some people don't want to be responsible for the riches. They don't want to be responsible to tithe on it. They don't want to be responsible to give on it. They don't want to be responsible to take care of it. Well, here's the good news. You're not going to be burdened with it. But for those of us who do want more, and people say those things, but they don't really believe it. They really, and maybe there are some who really believe they're supposed to just get by. But if you go in the scripture with me when we talk today, and you come out thinking that you're supposed to be a pauper and not a prince, we just need to go get you, well, I don't know, an exorcism or something, because there's something in you telling you something totally wrong and different than what the Bible says. And we're only really going to look at the Old Testament today. And so at the end of it, I think it's going to be really good. But go to Philippians 4:18. And so today we're just kind of talking about needs versus wants, provision versus promise. I'm going to tell you that God will never begin to provide until you know your purpose. Now, he provides for your needs. But there's a huge difference in provision for need and provision for promise. Bobby and I were talking the other day. He was talking about his house. They're building a house. And how he was limiting his thinking on how big the house could be. And listen, we've all been at this place. But if you're a good dad and you really love your children, and you really love, you want them to do better than you've done, wouldn't you want them to have nice stuff? Yeah. As long as it didn't have them. Yeah. As long as it didn't control them. Yeah. You know, say what you want about Donald Trump. And a lot of people have a lot to say about him. But he has three children that, despite their disadvantage of being children of millionaires, it's a disadvantage. Because I talk to people who are in that millionaire bracket, close to billionaires, and their families tore apart, and their children are going to hell, and their children are mutilated by drugs because they've been handed everything. But, you know, you got three kids there, and all of them seem to love him. Three or four? Four. Tiffany, too, right? Well, whoever. You see what I'm saying. They're all successful, and they all work hard. And, you know, it's not good to be given everything. My girls and my son want vehicles. Big surprise. I talked to my son the other day. I said, son, you keep doing it. He's got his own little business. He washes windows and he mows lawns. And so I shouldn't say little business. It's a growing business. I'm very pleased with him. But he keeps doing this. He's going to have enough to buy a nice truck. And I said, you know, you get $4,000 together, you can get you a little Tacoma. Start working out of it. He said, Dad, I don't want that anymore. I want a 2016. I said, son, now, you talk about limits. And so I start saying, well, son, come on. I mean, I don't know if you're going to get a 2016 for $4,000, but you could get a starter truck. And then I stopped myself. I said, let me tell you something. If you can believe God for it, you can have it. And just drive me around in it. That's all I'm asking. Well, you can drive the Hummer and I'll drive it every once in a while. But I would, and I actually, it ran through my head, what if God gave him that just because he desired it? What would you do? And I'd probably have 14 lessons a day telling him how to treat a truck and all this kind of stuff, because I know me. But that's not beyond God. It's just sometimes beyond us. But I have received everything in a love in full, and this is Paul talking in Philippians 4:18. But I have received everything in full and more. I'm amply supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent me, their fragrant aroma of an offering, an acceptable sacrifice which God welcomes and in which he delights. And my God will supply, liberally supply, fill until full, amplified, your every need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be the glory forever and amen. When you give to God with the right heart, it actually smells good to him. I mean, there's actually an odor to it in the heavens. When you get to heaven, things are going to smell different. You won't be driving by any landfills. You won't be driving by sewage plants. Things smell different. Things taste different. Why? Because it's pure and it's holy. And in Paul, when he's talking here, it's almost as if he's saying, hey, I'm good, guys. Thank you. But did you know at that point in time, he was in waist deep of human waste. He was in the lowest part of a dungeon. It's called the Maritime Prison, where people were sent to die. They were chained with their hands. And so he told me, you've heard me tell this before, their hands were chained up, and they were set there, and they were put there for at least 30 days, and no one ever survived it except Paul and Peter. Peter survived it once, Paul survived it twice. And that is when this sweet smelling, and he's actually saying, guys, it smelled so good. You can imagine when all he's smelling is waste, he's gone nose blind to everything that's horrible and putrid, and he smells this offering, and it's like, oh my God, it smelled so good. I'm amply supplied. Thank you so much. Standing in human waste, and they would throw dead bodies in there too, because the tide would come up. It used to be a cistern and place where water came from, but the tide would come up, come in, take everything and take it back out to sea. That was their sewage system. And that's where Paul was when he wrote this. It smelled good to him, and I can tell you it smells good to God when we give to somebody, or when we open the door for somebody, or when we give our time to somebody. There's a lot of guys in here that sow their time into other people that are coming up. We don't have any poor people. We have coming up people. Okay. Matthew 6:25. Therefore I say to you, don't worry about your life. How many of you can say this last week you didn't worry about your life at all, about nothing? Nothing. That means you put your hand in your pocket when you were going to buy something and you didn't think, well, when I buy this, I won't have that much more on my account. See? I mean, you ever think about the things we think about most? I do. Some people don't, but maybe that's good. I guarantee you the things we think about most are bad relationships and money. Yeah, relationships gone bad, money we don't have. And if that's what we're always thinking about, that's what we're always going to see. We have to turn the tide of our thinking, write your stuff down, and start seeing something different. He goes on to say, don't worry about what you're going to eat or drink. You guys, a lot of you know this scripture. Because look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet the Lord feeds them, the Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? Which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature and make you taller? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. This is pretty amazing. Because at the end of the service, I'm going to talk about Solomon and how he was arrayed. But here's the key. This scripture that Jesus said was as true then as it is true now. Solomon could not look any better or be any more beautiful than a lily of the valley, because the lily of the valley was just what it was. It was beautiful on the inside and the outside. Solomon had to put something on the outside to be beautiful. We have that same thing. Jesus is telling us, look at the lilies of the valley. I've taken care of them. I'll tell you this even, and I said this last service, and I believe it. God, he says that the birds neither sow nor reap, but he takes care of them. I don't believe we live under the curse of the law. I believe that, like Galatians says, we've been redeemed from the curse of the law. However, you do need to live like you're redeemed. You need to follow the principles of redemption. I believe in tithing. I believe in giving. You guys know that. But I'll tell you, even if I stopped giving everything today, if my son stopped loving me, he stopped giving. In fact, if he stopped doing anything at the house, I wouldn't stop feeding him. I wouldn't stop giving him a place to put a roof over his head. I wouldn't do that, and I don't believe God would do that to you, even if you didn't tithe and you didn't give. I will tell you, though, unless you enact the principles of prosperity that are listed in the Word, you won't see the abundant life you can have. It'll be when you get to heaven. And then you're still going to have to learn it. There's giving in heaven. Okay. There is. You give when you get to heaven. In fact, that's pretty much what you're doing. It's pretty much what everybody's doing all the time, is giving. I'm not talking about money. Let's get our head off money. We've been deceived by the enemy that that's everything. It's not. When we determine and we find out that wealth is an interior reality, it'll become an exterior reality.
That's good.
That's right.
Okay, go to Psalm 23. Psalm 23. There was one more I had in Luke. You go to Psalm 23 and I'll read this. It says, I say to you, my friends, don't be afraid of those who kill the body after they have no more than that they can do. And I say to you, my friends, it's Jesus talking again, don't be afraid of those who can kill the body and after that have no more that they can do. In other words, all they can do is kill your temple. All they can do is end your life. But I will show you, this is a really happy scripture, but I will show you whom you should fear, Jesus says. Jesus is supposed to be all sunshines and rainbows, right? Fear him who after he has killed, why'd you write it like this? Has the power to cast you in hell too. Yes, I say fear him. Now it says he has the power to, but he didn't build hell for humans. He built hell for Satan and his cohorts. He don't want to send anybody there. But it's saying don't fear men. Don't fear what men can do to you. You need to put your fear in God, who can do everything for you or can take you out, even though I don't believe he does that. In fact, most Christians and heathens don't need any help taking themselves out. They do a pretty good job of it themselves. Okay. Lord is my shepherd. This is Psalm 23. Let's be happy now. It says, and not five sparrows are sold for two copper coins, and not one of them is forgotten before the Lord, but the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't fear, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. You know why I think people lose their hair? Because they fear. It's just right there. I'm just saying, it's right there. So I've gone back to the Lord and I said, I want my original count back. The original count of number of hair. I used to have thick, curly hair. I'm not kidding. It wasn't always gray like this. When I started pastoring, that's when it started happening. I'm just playing. It was going gray when I started 16 years old. It started going gray. But even then, it was still curly. It was still thick. I'm calling it back. I told God I want my original count back. Do what you got to do. All right. And it is. It's coming back. Somebody ought to be happy for me. Celebrate with me. You'll get your hair too. All right. Before I read this, can you come help me with something? Yeah. Just want you to hold this. Just stand right there and hold this. I'm just going to fill it up, okay? I guess I've trained people right. Usually people pull it away and say, no, it's full. It's full. It's full. You're going to run over. The truth of it is that when his cup runs over, it gets me wet too. Amen. And the one on the other side of him. Thank you. You didn't do the right thing, but thank you. Actually, you did the right thing. It's just not good for my example. Normally people pull it away. It's filling up. It's filling up. You're going to overflow it. Now, if it was Coke or something like that, maybe they do it. I'll do it with Coke next time. You know, or milk. I don't want milk on. But in Psalm 23, it says, Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You notice he didn't say, I shall not need. There's needs and there's wants. When I shall not want, that means my wants are shall-notted. I shall not want because I already got my needs and I have all my wants. But the problem with most people's wants is they don't line up with God's will. Well, I want that lady. She's good looking. Well, Jack, you're married. You can't have another one. It don't work like that. Well, I want that car. I think that's nice, and I think I just want that car. Praying God for to get you one, but don't covet after somebody else's. Most times, people want things they want things easy instead of having to work hard for it. And I don't believe you have to work hard your whole life, but I guarantee you this. If you're going to come up and be a success, you will have to work hard at something. But the work ought to get easier as the further you go because you work smart and not hard. He goes on to say, he'll make me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Why? And this is talking about sheep and a shepherd. Why would a sheep be laying down in green pastures? Because it's full. Yeah. His stomach's full. He's just laying there. Oh, God, the green grass. Oh, I got a good shepherd. Oh, Jesus, he brought me to this green pasture. And there's the brook right there. If I could get up and get a drink, I would. But I just can't because I am so full of good grass. If sheep could talk. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of death, I'll fear no evil, for you're with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The rod also protects you. And notice you don't go through the valley of death. You just go through the shadow of it. So many people act like they're going through it, not the shadow of it. Shadow's got no power unless you give it to it. Don't watch horror movies. I had a whole story about it last service. I'm just cutting it to that. Don't watch horror movies because that's all you'll think about. You see a shadow and you will think it is death. You'll convince yourself because it's what you've put. You know, some people will go to a movie and they'll sit and they'll pay $10 or more. If it's past 6 o'clock, they'll pay more to sit through a 2.5 hour vision of evil and death. Did you know that the people that produced those had a vision of it before it came to pass? And don't tell me, well, it's just fake. Oh, horse crap, just fake. You don't go to look at it with the intention of knowing, well, it's all fake anyway. You go to look at it and see how realistic it could be. And then you wonder why you have nightmares. Or why you're cranky all the time. Or why you're hard to live with. My cup runs over. You anoint my head with oil. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You know, God prepares a table in the earth before you in the presence of your enemies for a reason, so your enemies see you, how prosperous you are, and at the table that you're sitting at that you didn't deserve, and they know they don't either, and they'll ask you questions why. But so many people, so many Christians hadn't even come to the table yet because they don't think they deserve it. I got a big newsflash. You don't deserve it, but God deserves it, and He says you do. Get to the table. Pull up, man. I'm not going to wait till the great by and by to experience. You won't be able to eat in front of your enemies. You won't have any enemies up there. Or enemas. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. That word follow means pursue me all the days of my life. And afterwards I'll live with my God forever in His home. That's the new Living Translation. Genesis 13:2. Okay, so we've got three different types of lands, three different types of livings. The land of not enough, just enough, and more than enough. Most people call the land of just enough the blessed life, but it's not. I'm going to tell you, so I'm going to talk to you about welfare here in just a second. God actually has a system for welfare, and it's not degrading. Welfare is not a bad word. Staying in welfare is a bad thing. Okay. You know, there's got to come a time. Okay, let me just talk about. Let me talk about Egypt just real quick. Moses led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. Egypt was a place of not enough. They didn't have the straw to even make their bricks. Now, if anybody, nobody in here has probably made bricks by hand. But anytime you're going to do that, even on these nature shows, they'll get mud together, but they'll put straw, they'll put hay, they'll put stuff in it to help hold it together. They had not enough in that land. Then they went across the Red Sea. From the Red Sea to Canaan's land, which Canaan's land is where Abraham went when he and Lot split up. He went to Canaan's land. Canaan's land became blessed because Abraham was there. It was dry and nasty desert, but it became blessed. It was an 11-day journey from the Red Sea to the Promised Land. But it took them 40 years to get there because they griped and complained, and they had to die. The first generation had to die off. Now, so many people get into the land of just enough or the wilderness and then end up in welfare. The wilderness was God's welfare place. Why? Because every morning they got up and they had food and they didn't have to work for it. Every night they went to bed and they had a fire above them to keep them warm. Every morning when they got up and it was hot in the desert, they had a cloud to keep them cool. When they needed rain, when they needed water, you know, Moses would hit the rock and they got water when there was something else that happened. But that was a land of provision for welfare, but never where they were supposed to stay. And they certainly weren't, they were supposed to be there 11 days. See, welfare is always a temporary measure for a circumstance to get you into a place where you can support yourself and live for yourself. Always. The government wants to keep people on welfare because it can control them with a penny. Can control them with a dollar bill. Why? Because then they are subservient to what the government can do for them, and they get in the welfare mentality and they're just lulled into it rather than getting out and doing it for themselves. That's why so many people love Bernie Sanders' plan. It's free. Everything's free. No, it's not. It's going to cost somebody. There's not some magic bean Bernie's going to grow. And it's just going to make colleges that don't cost anything. But we've been lulled in to believing this, to believing a lie. And we should be believing our way out. Amen. You know, there ought to come a point in time in your life when you don't want a handout. You don't want somebody else's leftovers. You don't want somebody else's droppings. Yeah. I don't mean droppings like people are, you know. I got to talk to you about Ruth. Because when Ruth was in the field, Boaz said, drop some wheat on purpose. Yeah. In other words, Ruth's provision had purpose with it. Well, I said that. Drop it on purpose. Why? Because there was a purpose to it. She would pick it up, and eventually, the field that she gleaned in, she owned. It's a great story of redemption. Anyway, in Genesis 13, and I'm just going to read these quickly, it says that Abraham went up from Egypt, he and his wife and all that they had and Lot with him, to the south. Abram was very rich in livestock, silver, and gold. Notice it's Abram and not Abraham. This is before the promise and the covenant of God was in effect. This was Genesis 13. But he had Lot with him, and he was rich in silver and gold and cattle. Right? It says this in verse 5. Lot also, who went with Abraham, had flocks and herds and tents. You got to understand, this wasn't 5 minutes later. Okay? Some of these verses are years apart. And they're telling a story of what happened. But because of Lot's association with Abram, he became rich in livestock, herds, tents. A lot of people read this, and this, ladies, you want another home, this is your verse. You don't sleep in a tent anymore, but if you like tents, you can have two. But you want another house? It's just right here. But anytime a Christian wants to come up, ain't good enough for you, it's good enough for me, it should be good enough for you. A church almost split because a pastor got his son a $200 pair of basketball shoes, and somebody in the church started riling up about it because they said, well, my son's got a $20 pair of basketball shoes, and it's good enough for me, it's good enough for you. I say leave the church and take everybody who believes with you. Get out of my house. But it's ridiculous. Why? Because people judge you unworthy because they won't work for it. They won't believe for it. They won't ride on your faith. It comes a time, point in time in your life, and you got to ride on your own faith. You got to get your own stuff going. And God provides. And it says, but Abram, before he even had covenant, was rich in livestock, silver, and gold. Those are all commodities. Okay? Then verse 5, Lot went with him. Now, it says, now the land was not able to support them. that they might dwell together, for the possessions were so great they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen. Now I'm going to paraphrase the rest. There was strife between the cattle guys for Abram and the cattle guys for Lot. And they were getting in fights, and Lot comes to Abraham, like, what are we going to do about this? Abram says, all right, we're going to have to split up. And so Lot, here's what I'll do. You choose the land you want to go to, and you go to it. And then I'll go to the other. If you choose the right, I'll go left. If you choose left, I'll go right. And it says Lot lifted his eyes and looked at the well-watered fields of where Egypt was and where Sodom was and all that. And he went there, and Abraham went to Canaan. So Abraham went where it was dry and nasty. But let me tell you something. Nothing can keep the blessing of God from you no matter where you go. Because if you're blessed, you're blessed. If you're blessed on the inside, it'll show. It has to show up on the outside. Look at the simplest thing. If somebody's bitter, you don't have to ask them if they're bitter. You're around 40 seconds and you'll know if they're bitter. Why? It's on the inside and it shows up on the outside. It's the same with anything else. So they split up, and Lot said, I'm going to take the nice green pastures. Big mistake. Everybody say stupid.
Stupid.
Lot was stupid. What'd he do? He cut himself off from his provision. His provision was in his association with Abram. Everybody knows, you know, when a baby's born, it has an umbilical cord. Why? Because it's receiving nutrition. It's receiving air. It's receiving everything. And if you cut the umbilical cord too quickly, it can hurt the baby. We had all our babies at home. She had them all in a bed. And I helped them get out and all that kind of stuff. And I was the one that cut the umbilical cord on all of them. And I waited too long on all of them. Why? Because I wanted to make sure there was no more pulse in the umbilical cord. Why? If there's pulse there, the baby's still feeding. The baby is still, it's still necessary to be connected. And if you cut yourself off from your provision too quickly, it's just like cutting off air to your brain. You'll start making stupid decisions, and that's what Lot did, and he ended up being right in the smack dab in the middle of Sodom and Gomorrah, and we know how that story turned out. If he'd have stayed with Abraham, he should have said, Abe, I'm with you, I love you, you're my uncle, everything I have is because of you. I'm sending all my guys away. In fact, I'm going to sell everything I got, and I'm giving everything to you, because even if I'm with you, I'm rich. But no, he got jealous. He got greedy. He said, I'm going to take that. I'm going to take this. And then we know how that happened and what happened. Now, I've told you about the welfare and wilderness. We've got to come into the land of more than enough. Amen?
Amen.
All right, I'm almost done. We have to overcome the habit of poverty. There is a habit of poverty. Let me just explain it to you real quick. I'm serious. I'm almost done. Like anything, it creeps in and tries to stay. That's why it's hard for some people to receive something good, and why some shun moving up. Now, there's Abraham and there's Moses. Abraham came before Moses. We are called the children of Abraham. Even in the New Testament, Jesus, in Luke, I think it was Luke 14. I'll tell you for sure. Anyway, I think it's Luke 14. There's a lady that was bent over from a spirit of infirmity for 18 years. She came into Jesus. Jesus was teaching on Sunday. It was law that you don't work on Sunday, but Jesus healed her. He said, woman, thou art loosed. In other words, he didn't pray for the infirmity. He told it to leave. Sometimes you don't need to be prayed for healing. You need a spirit gone. And so she stood up. She was healed. They griped at him because she healed somebody on the Sabbath. And he said, should not a daughter of Abraham be loosed from this evil thing? Why did he reference daughter of Abraham? Why did he say, should not a daughter of Moses be loosed? There's a very good reason. Because Abraham was the watermark of prosperity, the watermark of a good life in the Old Testament. We're still called the children of Abraham. I want to tell you that at the very minimum in a Christian's life, they should be living like Abraham was in the Old Testament. At the very minimum. Because now we're in a better covenant. Take it or leave it. You know, I'm just telling you the Bible. We ain't called the children of Moses. I don't want to be the son of Moses. I don't want to be a child of Moses. Why? Moses was the deliverer. And he never got into the promised land. Come on. Let the dots connect, folks. Come on. Open your head up. If you're resisting this because you think I'm talking about prosperity, well, you're right about that, but don't resist it. Everybody wants better. Not a one here that doesn't want anything better. If you got a good guitar, you want a better one. If you got a pair of shoes, you want better ones. That's not wrong. And as soon as we quit beating each other up over wanting more, we'll all move up. Christians are some of the worst about beating each other up over things. T.D. Jakes, man, he's worth $150 million, right? Something like that. Richest preacher in America. I'm happy. Why shouldn't I be? He's telling people about Jesus Christ. And he tells them, well, I'm telling you, he tells them. I want to go rent some of his congregation to sit among you. And I used to judge him. I used to say, oh, it's all emotion. That's all just he's talking and he's bragging. Yeah. And I'm keeping all that good stuff away from me. Why? Because when I judge somebody else unworthy, I do the same to myself. And man, I started celebrating. I watch him on the iPad and I say, come on, Bishop. Come on, Bishop. Yeah, that's a good word. One of these days I end up preaching like him. Anyway. Then we'll find out if there's any racist here. All right. Emotion is something God gave you. Emotion can actually help you get ahead. Because if you'll get emotional in a good way about what you don't have, you don't have a healing, but if you get emotionally excited and praise, it actually helps your body. It sends medicine to your body. Everything you need to heal is right within you. It's not in the pill. Pills pacify. Spirit saves. I'm not saying anything wrong. If anybody's there, I'm not saying anything wrong about it. I've taken medication before. I'm not saying anything wrong about it. But I am telling you, the ultimate source of your healing lies within you. We'll have to talk about that another time. Last thing I wanted to tell you was, be a son, be a daughter of Abraham, not Moses. I'm thankful for Moses. He was a type and shadow of Jesus. Bring us out. And the Lord told me before service, I don't mean to hurt an audible voice, but inside me I knew he said to say this to somebody for this service. Someone has said these words or something like it. Well, I don't want to hurt their feelings. They're my friend or family. Or if I try to move up, it'll make them mad and they'll leave. Listen, if somebody is not your friend after you're a millionaire, they were never your friend before you were. And I mean family too. There's some family that tries to Facebook me or call me and I don't answer the phone. I don't want what they have. And so I don't give. My time is precious. My time is seed. I'm not going to give my seed to dogs. Well, you're calling your family dogs? Some of them. I don't mean that bad, but that's how they act. Just run around after crumbs off a table. And that's the way they live, off everybody else. We can't live that way. We got to learn to do for ourselves. We got to learn to come up. I felt like that was just really important, that you know association matters. If this message, if you're hearing this message, bothers you, it's probably because it needs to bother you. You probably need to come back and hear more. Because I'm never going to say something like all this message and then take an offering. Because then I would be doing it for the wrong reasons. People think, well, then if I give, I'll get. That's true, but you need to give for the right reasons. Last thing was this, that Moses' temple took about $30 million to build Moses' temple. Now Moses' temple was the tent. What did the temple tent, what did it house? Anybody? The Ark of the Covenant. I just want to make sure everybody, and what did the Ark of the Covenant have inside it? Raiders of the Lost Ark. It had a budding rod representing it. It had manna. And it had the Ten Commandments. And it represented the presence of God. I want you to keep that in mind just in this last few minutes. Moses' temple took about $30 million to make. The golden lampstand alone. Do you remember that golden lampstand that was in the Holy of Holies was $1.5 million in today's values for gold? Just a lampstand. It was the menorah. It's like the menorah. $7 million. Most Christians throw a fit over spending $85 on a chair. You know they're going to have issues if we got a gold lampstand worth 1.5. Well, actually, I'm going to sell it and I'm going to buy something. I'm buying a building. Yeah. And I'll tithe. Don't worry about it. And I'll give some of it too. Thing is, we think too low. We think in the shadows instead of the light. We live in somebody else's shadows instead of stepping into our own light. Okay. Solomon's temple. David was not able to build the actual temple of God. Solomon built it because Solomon's hands weren't soaked with blood. David's hands, he was a warring king. Solomon was a peace king. And I want to tell you the cost of the temple. The reason I'm doing this is because after I tell you this, you'll understand. For the temple, I'm only giving you value for gold and silver. I'm not including the cedar, the overlaid cedar and gold that lined the hallways in the Holy of Holies. I'm not including the precious stones. I'm not including Solomon's ivory throne. Ivory throne. Ivory. Elephants. That was a lot of elephants got killed for that throne. But, you know, and then also the man hours. You know, it took 180,000 workers. It took 7.5 years to build. It's interesting, 7.5. Anyway, 7.5 years to build. Did you know that after Solomon did all this, because they fell away from God, the Syrians and everybody came in and they raped the temple. Came in and pillaged it. Took everything. Hezekiah, when he was dying, Hezekiah came about 400, I think it was 400 years, or 400 years, 300 after Solomon, and the first thing he instituted, he rebuilt the temple and reintroduced praise and worship into the temple, and he began to build again. But did you know in the end, he took those cedars that lined the temple, he broke all the gold off of it and sold it to an Assyrian army king to help him fight a war. Even God's own people have raped his temple. And I know that's a hard word, but that's taking something that doesn't belong to you. It belongs to somebody else. That was God's purity. That was God's temple. So, 7.5 years, 180,000 people to make it. The totals. There were 3,000 talents of gold. No, I'm sorry. This is David's personal seed. This is like if I was going to build a building and I put my money into it and everybody else sowed after that. David's personal seed was 3,000 talents of gold, 7,000 talents of high-grade silver. That's 3.6 billion in gold and 140 million in silver. One guy. You want to know what everybody else sowed? There were 1 million talents or 37.5 tons of choice silver sowed into the building of the temple. There was 100,000 talents or 3,750 tons of gold sown for the building of the temple. Together, in today's values, that equals, in silver and gold alone, $145 billion for a building. But God said, it's worth it because it's mine. And we get bent and twisted over $2 or $3 million something. We all got to come up from the one that's working at the very bottom step to the one that's working at the very top step. We all got to come up together. You know, even if Lord told me this when Amy was doing tithes and offerings, we don't like getting up here and pulling on people for money. In fact, we don't. I don't think you can look back and say, well, you talk about money a lot. Go back and listen to my messages before you start telling me what I talk about. I've had people tell me that before. Send me emails. You sure talk about this a lot. Go back and listen. Go back and look at my messages. You won't find a whole lot on it. But I'll tell you what, if it'll rid you of a spirit, I'll talk about it more. Amen. And I heard the Lord say, if you had 100% tithers, no matter what the amount was, it creates more energy for the miracles I need to do. Because God looks at us equally. He doesn't look at me differently than he looks at you. Did you know that? Oh, that's my alarm telling me shut up. Somebody says you need to obey it. My reward when I come home to the Lord is no different than your reward. I don't get some, you know, bump or bonus because I was a pastor or a ministry leader. You think about that before you want to go into the ministry. What you do get is judged harder because you're responsible for souls. You see, I could preach heresy, and even if you fell into it, I'd be responsible for it. And I even believe in some cases God would spare the person because they were led wrong. What did the word say? Any of you who would lead one of these little ones astray, it'd be better off you're never born or that you had a millstone tied around your neck and you're pitched in the ocean. Leadership. Everybody apply. It's great. 145 billion dollars in silver and gold, not including all the rest of the stuff. Now, let me ask you, this is my closing question. Where is the temple of God today? Huh? We are? And where is the Holy of Holies? Where is the presence of God? So what's our problem? If God did all that on the outside to put His presence in, why wouldn't He do the same for us to put His presence in? Except what happens is this. It's the opposite. He puts His presence in His temple so that His presence comes out of the temple.
Yes.
And He doesn't do it on a credit card. He does it debt-free. All right, everybody stand up.